Coming up on Need to Know, Mayor Lovely Warren is in the studio to talk about what she's called her number one priority since campaigning for the mayor's office, education. What can a mayor really do to improve educational outcomes for the city's children? We'll get the details on her plan. Also on the show, we'll learn about a nursery school ahead of its time in Rochester. And WXXI's Carlet Cleare joins us to talk Greentopia Festival. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. Education seems to be at the root of every problem Rochester faces, and yet it's also the heart of every solution. That's according to Rochester Mayor Lovely Warren, who made education a focal point of her campaign with the release of 7 strategies called the Warren Education Plan. So where do things stand now with the mayor's plan, and how is she working with the city school district and area charter schools to change the course of urban education in Rochester? Mayor Lovely Warren joins us now to take on those questions and more. And Mayor Warren, I appreciate you being here today. I understand that this has been a difficult time the past 7 days for you, for many of us in the greater Rochester community, to come to terms with the death of Rochester police officer Daryl Pearson, and also the loss of Larry and Jane Glazer. And I want our audience to know, I initially asked the mayor to join us to talk about education, and that was prior to the events of the tragedies of the past 7 days. So we will be sure to discuss those events at the end of our conversation.
Yes, thank you for having me.
Thank you. So, Mayor, while you were campaigning over a year ago, you said, if elected, education would be your number one priority, and you laid out an extensive plan with 7 strategies to take on this issue. And for those unfamiliar with the mayor's plan, we have a graphic listing those strategies, and I just want you to talk to me about where things stand right now in regards to the Warren Education Plan.
Well, we are well on our way into the plan. We will be announcing really soon the mayor's 3-to-3 strategy. I put together a great team of people that I called the Early Learning Council. And they went through and talked about and saw ways in which the mayor's office could be influential in early education. We know that the early stages of life is really determines whether a child will have a successful educational future. And so we want to focus on ages 3 to grade 3. We want to make sure that children that are involved in high early learning programs have the resources and the support that they need to have a successful educational outcomes. We want to make sure that we have our recreation centers as well as our libraries, early learning spaces within them, so that parents as well as our children feel comfortable coming in. Right now, we're going through an evaluation of our Department of Recreation program to make sure that we are inclusive of younger children. In the past, we focused on ages 6 to 18. When it comes down to our DRIES program, we will start to focus on early learning as a portion of that. The Early Learning Council met with not only parents, but also providers, private providers, teachers, and looked at what we can do as a community as a whole, and came up with basically 4 different strategies. They believe that the mayor needs to be more involved when it comes down to parental involvement. They need to be more involved when it comes down to making sure that early learning is funded properly and consistently across the board, that we need to make sure that we are giving parents the tools and the options and the information so that they can be better parents to their children in early stages, as well as they wanted us to make sure that we're working with all of our governmental partners to ensure that our children are getting the best life for them as possible.
So a big emphasis right now in terms of your plan on the early childhood education aspect. And I know you mentioned the Early Learning Council, which you formed. You also formed the Early Education Commission in this past winter, led by former school board member Alan Williams. And there's 4 points that they made, the Early Learning Council, very intense in terms of the work that you can do as a mayor. I want to get your take because these two groups are making recommendations. They're doing research. They're doing studies. You said they went out there talking with parents, talking with the school districts, and et cetera. I guess in terms of the work of these two groups and the recommendations that they made to you, how will those recommendations steer you in the city in terms of moving forward and addressing the needs that they recommended? Because when it comes to early childhood education, because you're limited really in terms of what you can do with some of these things.
Well, it's only one group. It's the Early Learning Council. We do have, Alan Williams is the Director of Special Projects and Educational Affairs. And so his role is to be that liaison between the mayor's office and all aspects of education, whether it's higher ed or, you know, early learning when it comes down to Head Start and preschool, but also with the city school district as well, and so and our charter schools. So his role is to be that liaison, make sure that I know what's going on in our school system as a whole. The Early Learning Council, their focus really was on how do we prepare our kids to have a better, successful future? What are we doing wrong, and what can we do better from the administration's perspective, the city's perspective? And that group came up with, you know, four concrete suggestions, and we are developing a plan around those suggestions. You know, one of the things that we do currently have in our libraries have been going out into homes, and they have reading and literacy aids that our students that are in the city school district or from the city school district that work in our libraries, so that we can make sure that our young people that are coming there are getting the support that they need. We also have a number of them going into the home, literacy aids going into homes to teach not only the children how to read, but a lot of times they find out that the parents are functionally illiterate. And so they are also working with the parents and the families to build that up. Started in Northeast Rochester, and they have been able to receive a grant, and they will be expanding that. Looking at how to make our libraries and our recreation spaces better and more conducive to early learning for our younger children and their families. Create a safe space, safe environments for our young people to come in and learn. When it comes down to working with partnerships, you know, the president of the school board, Van White, has been very supportive, as well as the superintendent, and working and talking to them about what options we have. They have gone to a full day program of pre-kindergarten in many of the schools, and we also understand that, you know, learning really starts at home. And so working with our community partners, we are looking at how we can help parents and give parents the tools that they need. One of the things that, you know, being a young mom myself, I look at the fact that what should my daughter know? You know, when should she know her ABCs? When should she learn how to identify her letters and count and her colors? Well, there really is no tool that has been developed that is readily accessible to parents that you can give them unless you go on the internet and you do your research and things like that. So we need to develop a process where it's easier for parents to get that information. Before the deputy mayor was on the Rock the Future program, I have actually decided that I want to sit in the room when it comes down to Rock the Future, because this is the community organization, a community group of all aspects of education from the cradle to career. And being in the room and being able to influence that process is where I need to be. And I think that that was one of the recommendations by the Early Learning Council, to be able to influence education from the beginning and to the end. And that's a way that the mayor can play an extensive role in that.
So it sounds like a greater utilization of things such as the public library, recreation centers, and then creating these tools were part of the recommendations. And are those recommendations then a part of this 3-to-3 initiative that you'll be unveiling soon?
Yes.
And with the most recent state test data, I'm sure you've seen these results, about 7% of Rochester kids, city school students, proficient in math, about 6% proficient in English. If your goal is for every three-year-old then to be academically successful by the time that they reach third grade, are we talking about 100%? And do you think that's attainable? And is there a budget? You know, is there a budget that you're thinking in your head that you think could to help make something like that happen?
We currently already have all the resources and the tools available to make a lot of this happen. when it comes down to not necessarily throwing money at a problem, because the money is not going to fix it. It's what do you do with the tools that you currently have? If we look at our recreation centers and our libraries and look at how we can make those more family friendly, a place where young parents can come and utilize that space better and more effectively and efficiently, we're gonna do that. And that may take a capital investment. When you talk about the community partners, listen, we do pre-K well in this community and we always have, but something happens between pre-K and kindergarten and third grade that the children fall off. What's that disconnect? Making sure that during the summertime and after school, when we get the children, that we have the tools in place and the people in place to make sure that they are, doing their homework, that they know how to do their homework, and that we are asking the question. One of the things that we are currently working with the school district as well as our libraries and our recreation centers for is a one pass. So if you show up in school one day and you or are not in school that day and you actually come to the recreation or the library, when you swipe your pass, we know that. And we can ask the question, why weren't you in school today? Well, what happened? What's going on? Is there something I can help you with? So bringing a holistic community approach to the issues that we currently have. And so it's not just the school district operating in a silo or the city of Rochester operating in a silo or the library system. It is, we have to work together to improve the outcomes of our children, and working together, we'll be able to do that.
Mayor, I'm going to transition just a little bit before our time comes to an end, and I want to spend a few minutes talking about the events of the past week. And it's been quite a tenure for you, and I'm sure you've reflected on that just a bit the past 7 days. And you said that the city of Rochester has lost a few heroes in the past week. And I want to start with Rochester Police Officer Daryl Pearson, a moving tribute to his life and his service at the funeral, Blue Cross Arena, on Wednesday. What can we learn from a tragedy like this, and how can we apply that knowledge moving forward?
Well, we have work to do. And I walked away, and my hope and my sincere hope was that this could have torn our community apart, or it could have brought us together. And I wanted our officers to know that they have a community that's behind them, that we're all in this together. And we recognize that we have issues of concern and we want to deal with our criminals and things like that. But we also want to support the good that's happening in our city. And our officers work hard and they put their uniform on every day and go out there and serve this community. And we want to thank them for that and recognize them for that. And I think that this community showed, from all over the country. We had people that came here, officers, that stood in solidarity with us. We had our clergy and just everyday Rochesterians that were there, that had their, that had their hand above their heart, just showing this family, Officer Pearson's family, that, we care, we're going to be here for you. But also just our men and women in blue, that this is a community that sticks together and we're going to get through this together.
And as we close, the Glazers, Larry and Jane Glazer, we also lost them as well. Details are, we still don't have them in terms of what led to their plane crashing near Jamaica on Friday. You called Larry the father and patron saint of the redevelopment of downtown Rochester. I pose a similar question. Larry was the face of a number of incredible redevelopment projects taking place in Rochester. How do we move forward in his absence to really ensure that his vision is carried out?
Well, that's the important part, making sure that his vision is carried out. We don't want to drop the ball when it comes down to making sure that Rochester becomes that beacon of hope that, Larry had envisioned. And I think that his death, his untimely death, and we, our hearts go out to his family and his children, him and Jane's children. We want to make sure that we continue to go forward. We have taken the necessary steps to talk to, many of his partners, as well as Ken Glazer, to not only express our condolences, but to say, listen, we're committed to making sure that your father and your mother's dream come true. We recognize that this is a tough time, but we're here for you. And that's the most important part.
Mayor Lovely Warren, thank you so much for your time today. WXXI News provides complete coverage of these stories on our website, WXXINews.org, and you can listen for the latest during Morning Edition and All Things Considered on WXXI AM 1370 and WRUR FM 88.5. And in the spirit of my conversation on education with the mayor, I want to tell you about a nursery school. Now, this is a school you may not have heard about. It began operating in Rochester in 1926, and it still serves city kids today. The executive director tells me it has been and always will be a school for everyone. Kids of all racial backgrounds and faiths, kids with developmental disabilities, and kids who are blind or deaf. The nursery school recently caught the attention of a local women's art group determined to help keep the school open for years to come.
Nearly 90 years ago, a Rochester woman with a vision and the gumption to see it through to completion created what some have called one of the city's best kept secrets. Her name is Harriet Blanche Jones. That secret is the Friendship Children's Center.
I think, according to my father, that she was beginning to see that women had to begin to work. And that meant that no one was going to be home with the kids. And she, education, as far as she was concerned, it was important that everybody knew how to read.
The year was 1926. Jones was working as a kindergarten teacher with the Rochester City School District. But her great niece, Kate Jocelyn, says it was her interest in nursery schools, in particular for kids living in poverty, that led her to leave her job and start what was originally named Friendship Nursery.
The big thing that was important to her was that people paid for the nursery school. Everybody had to pay something. I think it was a dime a day or whatever. It wasn't a huge amount of money. But her feeling was people would be more invested in it if they paid something. I think she hid her own light under a bushel. I don't think that we in the family had any idea what a pioneer she was.
Women just started voting, for God's sakes. Think about it. You know what I mean? They just started to vote, and now she's running a business. I mean, that's just amazing to me.
Joy DeGennaro McMurtry is the executive director of Friendship Children's Center. She says Jones's innate business sense not only got the nonprofit nursery a permanent home on Fernwood Avenue, but kept it funded for decades.
I can show you pictures where I think she literally posed children and made them look sad so that people would donate money to this cause.
Do you know this number?
DeGennaro McMurtry says Harriet Jones was ahead of her time, leading the way for early childhood education in Rochester. And her vision is still being carried out. Friendship now serves 75 kids, ages 1 to 4, most from the area neighborhood.
You're gonna look till you see the numbers.
The goal is to prepare children for school through varied educational experiences.
I have never seen so many children afraid to touch worms.
Universal pre-K is also offered through a contract with the city school district. But Friendship has taken a few hits.
Subsidy cuts have been really tough on our classroom sizes. I'll be perfectly honest, we've lost a lot of children because they've lost their funding. Families have lost their funding for child care.
It costs about $250 a week to send one child to a Monroe County daycare center. There are subsidies available to low-income families to help with the cost, but the county has placed a freeze on those funds for new applicants. So, in the spirit of Harriet Jones, Friendship is getting creative in its effort to start a scholarship fund for families.
We have been doing celebrations with these folding vintage church chairs that have been stored in my shed since at least the 1930s. We would have to sand them and clean them and dust them, and you know, people were snagging their clothes on them, so we stopped using them.
But now they've found a new purpose. The women of the local art group Draw learned about the chairs and the mission of Friendship Children's Center and offered to help. They commissioned emerging and professional artists throughout Rochester to paint one of the 45 vintage chairs for an upcoming auction to benefit the families of Friendship.
So for this particular project, I chose to paint moths. I cut them out to kind of give a three-dimensional aspect to it.
Every artist has a story. There's one chair that is draped by a coat, and the young man lost his brother tragically, so he took his coat and put it in concrete and laid it on the back of the chair so that it would be forever, you know, immortalized on this chair. Everybody has a special reason for why they painted.
Friendships Take a Seat, Make a Difference auction kicks off on September 11th. Joy DeGeneiro McMurtry says funds raised will go towards a scholarship fund, arts and culture experiences for friendship kids, and an emergency fund for families who need the basics, such as groceries and diapers.
They get to know you, not just a number, or not just a check, or not just, oh, it's your kid. They know all these children by the first and last name. They know the parents. Best place in the world.
Best place in the world. That's how friendship intends to keep it for years to come.
The friendship chairs are now on display at the Rundell Library in downtown Rochester through October 9th. To participate in the online auction, go to biddingforgood.com/friendship. You can also place a bid using your smartphone, bforg.com/friendship. The online auction runs now through midnight on October 9th. Also in the arts, the women of Draw, who sponsored the Friendship Chair Project, now have their latest work on display at the Geisel Gallery at 1 Balchin Lawn Place through the end of this month. If you're looking for something to do this weekend, for one, you should head to WXXI on Saturday for our open house. We'll be here from 10 to 2, and there's something for everybody. So bring the whole family, and the best part, it's free. Carlet Cleare joins me in the studio to talk about another event taking place this weekend you'll want to check out, the Greentopia Festival. Carlet?
That's right, Helen. After you visit WXXI for the open house on Saturday, you can enjoy the Greentopia Fall Festival right behind the station here at High Falls. The two-day celebration is all about sustainability. Joining me to share more is co-founder of Greentopia, Michael Phillipson. Thank you, Michael, for being here today to share more with us.
Thanks, Carlet.
So this is the fourth annual Greentopia Festival that's taking place this weekend. Can you just tell us, you know, why should people come to this festival? What's in it for them?
Well, people should come to this festival because people should come to High Falls and see what an incredible jewel Rochester has here in the middle of its city. Also, people should come to the festival because there'll be a ton of great stuff to do. It's free for families. There's only one small paid event, but really the rest of the festival is all free. And this year, in a special twist, it goes from 10 a.m. to 10 p.m. on Saturday. So it's really an all-day, almost all-night festival, which allows us to do some great nighttime stuff down at High Falls. In addition, the fashion show will be on Friday, the night before, in the High Falls garage with an incredible creative team of Sean Dud Woody and Athi Georgiou, and they'll be putting together an Alice in Wonderland type fashion show. It is not to be missed.
This is the From the Ground fashion show, which
highlights
local designers who use plastic and recycled materials.
You won't find any of these fashions necessarily in any of the local boutiques, but what you will find is an incredible array of creative ideas from some of the young and up-and-coming designers in our city and in our neighborhoods that really can show off their creativity with all kind of upcycled, recycled, and extreme materials.
And just for folks at home who may not quite understand the concept and the mission behind the Greentopia Festival, what is it?
Well, the Greentopia Festival is really was founded to really showcase all of the sustainable and resilient things people can do to live a greener life. And so our only goal really is that people come away entertained, of course, but also thinking about how they manage their waste, how they manage their energy. They can learn about that stuff at Greentopia. And as long as they come away with one good green idea, we're pretty happy. And we're also pretty happy that they've actually visited High Falls.
And I understand that the alternative fuel vehicle auto show is back, but it's with a bit of a twist this time.
Yes, we'll have the cars right in Brown's race. You'll be able to actually test drive a couple of the selected models. And this year, for the very first time, we'll be having a Tesla on display. And many people want to see that Tesla and would love to see one. They're hard to find, but we got one for Greentopia. So come on down and see all the great alternative cars.
And just like our open house, it's family friendly. Just talk about what's in it for kids. What can mom and dads expect?
Well, for kids, we have an incredible kids zone again this year. Brand new this year, we have a rock climbing wall from the National Guard that is really sort of oriented toward kids and young adults and even adults. You'll be able to climb that rock climbing wall. Ganondagan will be there. A music place will be there. Our Rochester Museum and Science Center will be there with some displays as well for kids. So there'll be plenty for kids to do. And then there's music all day.
Now I see that Michaela Davis is returning as a headliner.
Yes, she'll be outside on our Platt Street stage, which will be all sort of Americana headlining, music. Inside in the atrium stage will be the Society for Chamber Music in Rochester, Village Idiots, Rochester Lyric Opera, Eastman Saxophone Project, and I think I forgot one. Oh, jazz. Yeah. Jeff Campbell will be there for the first time with a jazz quartet from Eastman.
Can't forget jazz.
Yeah.
And also, what, in terms of there's new things that are coming, and I know that there's this fire performance.
Yes, at night from about 6:30 on, the focus shifts to the bridge. We will have a drum circle from the Genesee Valley, followed by Michael Burritt and a percussion ensemble from Eastman playing an incredible piece by a Greek composer. You'll hear the drums echoing off the gorge walls. Mark Groening will do a live painting performance during that. After that, we will have a different spin, a fire spinning and fire, amazing fire dance troupe that'll be there as well.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Michael Phillipson, co-founder of Greentopia Festival, thank you for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
To learn more about the events taking place at the Greentopia Festival this weekend, go to greentopiafest.com. And that's it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Helene B. and Duty Hofer. Thanks for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. I'll see you next week.